Julian.
Afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this seminar, Professor Guy Fong Lee. Professor Lee was our founding head of the EE department at CTU. I can see many of our colleagues here. So without Professor Lee, we won't be here today. And also there are many good friends of Professor Lee's here today. And actually, I'm very pleased to have Professor Lee with us again, as he has already retired a few years ago. And this time, he come to CTU for about 3 weeks. And this is the first talk, but on non-technical things. For those who are interested in Professor Lee's technology, technical knowledge in the internet in particular, you may attend his talks starting from next week for two talks, also on Wednesday. I think Professor Lee needs no introduction for most of us because he is famous in the antenna field worldwide. He received this Clouds Antenna Award from IEEE AP Society, which represents he is one of the top antenna experts in the world. And Professor Lee is also a distinguished educator and administrator. As you can see here, he is the Dean Emeritus of Engineering at University of Mississippi, and also many other important key positions in other universities. He was also with NASA and UCLA. And for me, without Professor Lee, I wouldn't be here because he gave me the job as CTU about how many years ago?
Don't mention
that. So without further ado, let's welcome Professor Kai Fong Lee.
I would like to thank Professor Mann, who's not here, but he's the one who has the money. And also Professor Lok for the opportunity to visit City University again. I have lost track of the number of times that I come back to visit since I left Hong Kong 30 years ago. Every time I came back, I feel I'm coming home. I almost choke, you know. As you can infer from Professor Lok's introduction, my entire career was in engineering education and research. So you must find it odd that I'll be speaking on music to an audience in an engineering department. This guy must be crazy, right? So I would like to start the talk by posing this question. What has music to do with engineering education? I would follow with two more questions. What is classical music? And is classical music boring? After addressing these questions, I would tell you a personal story of my first encounter with classical music. Then I would briefly go through the various types of compositions and brief comments on some major composers. The core of this talk is section 7, in which we will hear examples of the various human emotions and feelings invoked in classical music. I will play various pieces, mostly from YouTube, and some recorded music to illustrate this different emotions that was described or invoked in classical music. In section 8, I will say a few notes about a few words about operas. The talk then proceed with suggestions for beginners and end with concluding remarks and homework assignments for those who are interested, okay? As well as reference materials for further exploration. So let's begin with the question. What has music to do with engineering education? To shed some light on this, let us look at the engineering curriculum at MIT, universally recognized as one of the best engineering schools in the world. All MIT engineering programs are ABET accredited. And ABET requires that you must have a general education component. At MIT, part of this general education component is the HASS requirement, where HASS stands for Humanity, Arts, and Social Sciences. 8 semester courses are required, with some rules for selecting the courses to ensure a balance between breadth and depth. Naturally, one favorite art subject is music. And then MIT has a very strong music department with 20 faculty members and some 33 music courses, some of which are shown on this slide. I think much more than this, but you can see it covers both contemporary music, music theory, and so forth, as well as classical music. Let us also look at another institution known for its excellence in engineering education, the California Institute of Technology. At Caltech, a recent survey of the student body revealed that nearly 25% of undergrad and graduate students are involved in the study or performance of music. Music plays a significant role in the lives of a large number of students. The number of music courses offered at Caltech is not as much as MIT, but still quite substantial. And here are 13 courses, and I list here a few. Now it is also perhaps interesting to look at what about at your own university, City University of Hong Kong. Here, engineering students have to satisfy the so-called, you know more than I do, so distributed requirements, which requires 12 credit units from 3 areas. One area is arts and humanities. So there is opportunity for students, engineering students, to take music courses. However, I hope there's no music faculty here. The music courses offered at CTU is rather limited. And if you go to their website, this is all I can find. And if you compare these courses with those at MIT, you draw your own conclusion, okay? So the conclusion from the above is that the value of music in the education of engineering students is well recognized in engineering institutions abroad and in Hong Kong. So now the second question. What is classical music? Every one of us is form of music in one form or another. Even though few of us play a musical instrument well or are knowledgeable in music theory. My experience is that most students are attracted to popular music, and only a minority will enjoy classical music. In fact, many students, or any people for that matter, would stay away from classical music. As soon as the name classical music is mentioned, because they have the notion that classical music is boring and it is for elites only. One of the purposes of my talk is to try to convince you that this notion may not be correct. Indeed, classical music is like a big treasure island containing many treasures. Some treasures are easy to find, while others demand various degrees of effort. But first, I need to explain what I mean by classical music in the context of this talk. There is no clear definition of classical music. If you look for a clear definition, you'll be disappointed. But I think you agree, when you hear it, you know it, right? This is classical and this is not. Now, a very famous music professor, Professor Craig Wright of Yale University, offers the following comparison between classical and popular music. I'll read a two or three, and then there's some 5 points listed. The first, classical music relies on acoustic instruments whose sounds are not electronically altered, such as the trumpet, violin, piano, etc. Popular music often uses mechanically enhanced sounds, such as those produced by electrically amplified guitars and basses, electronic synthesizers, and computers. Second comparison, classical music relies greatly on preset written music or musical notation. So the work of a symphony, for example, is to some extent a fixed quantity, a fixed entity, which will always be performed more or less the same way. Popular music relies more on oral and oral transmission of the work, and the work can change greatly from one performer to another. You never see performers reading from a written musical piece at a pop concert. I didn't know this until I saw this, and indeed, if you look at the pop concerts, they don't have any music in front of the performer. And in classical music, the rhythmic beat often rests beneath the surface. You have to really look for it. But popular music foregrounds a recurring heavy beat. The last 2 points, I think I'll let you read it if you are interested to save time. So the third question, to answer the question, what is classical music in the context of this talk, I would take it as the music in Europe and America in the time span from 1600 to 1950 by a certain group of composers, the representatives of which are listed in the next several slides. Within this era, some 350 years, it can be divided into the following periods: Baroque, classical, romantic, and modern. Okay, the older period is called Baroque period, from 1600 to 1750. Preceding the Baroque period were the medieval and also the Renaissance period. These earlier periods were dominated by church music. In the Baroque period, music flourished in complexity and scope. Baroque music is characterized by an expressive melody and a strong support bass. In addition, a single musical piece tended to project a single mood or expression of feeling, which is not the case in classical and romantic period. Composers in this period include Bach, Handel, and Vivaldi. Classical period. In this period, music settled into several well-defined forms. The main forms were the sonata, the symphony, the concertos, the quartets. I'll say a few words about this later. Compositions in the classical period were balanced, structural, and orderly. Unlike the Baroque period, there are strong contrasts in moods and keys within a music piece or even within a movement. The prominent composers in this classical period include Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, and Schubert. Romantic period. Beethoven, although commonly regarded to be in the classical period, was actually the composer who initiated the Romantic period, which broke out of classical strictness and became more expressive and emotional. The themes are bigger, longer, and more expansive, and rhythms are less straight. The Romantic composer regarded himself and his art very seriously. To him, music is not only for entertainment, but it is a passionate expression of feelings and thoughts. And the composer in this period is pretty extensive. The more prominent, well-known ones are shown in red: Chopin, Verdi, Brahms, Tchaikovsky, and so forth. So that's the Romantic period. Now, when it comes to the modern period, then some composers remain in the Romantic style, but most composers move on. New music, new styles, and new ideas evolve. There are no rules. The only rules is there are no new rules. And irregular rhythms and dissonant signs are common. Composers in this period, when one piece called The Rite of Spring by Stravinsky was first performed in 1913, riots broke out because people were not used to the new sound. Okay. So in this period, there are again many composers. The better known ones are shown in red. Okay, now the third question: is classical music boring? As I mentioned already, many people stay away from classical music because they have the notion that it is only for elites and it is boring. To address this notion, let me first play a few tunes. So now we are playing music. And hopefully this would prevent you from sleep, okay? How many have not heard this before? I don't see any hands. So you have heard of this before, okay? Okay, second piece. I don't see any hand that says no. Okay, so he's trying to play a trick on me. I'll skip the third one to save time. Okay. You first heard it when you were a baby. Have anybody not heard this before? Again, no. Oh, one. Your mom didn't play this? Okay. Okay, finally, the last one. Again, anyone haven't heard this before? This is the song of the bullfighter, right? So the point is, you actually are familiar with all these tunes, except you may not realize they are rooted in classical music. The first one is from Rigoletto, I think so, by Verdi. Second one, of course, Beethoven's Ninth Symphony. Third one is Brahms. The cradle song was by Brahms. And the last one, the bullfighter form, is from opera Carmen by Bizet. So, in fact, these tunes were taught when I was in elementary school or middle school. For my generation, that's when they were taught, and because they were great music. Okay, so I guess it's safe to say that all these tunes are not boring. Am I right? Are they boring? No, they are not. But does this mean that all classical music are not boring? No. Okay. Oh, I forget about this. Okay, so most of us are familiar with these tunes. I have gone through this already. I skipped the third one. It's actually from the New World Symphony by Dvořák. Di-da-da-di-da-da. But I didn't play it. So, as I say, they're all very nice, but it doesn't prove that all classical music are not boring. So for myself, which is a lay person, as far as music is concerned, I would put classical compositions in several categories. The first one is immediately appealing. Examples are those compositions of most of Haydn, Mozart, and early and middle Beethoven. Second category, I would characterize it as appealing, but only after repeated listening. The first time you may not like it, but after repeated listening, then you will begin to appreciate. The third one requires serious effort. You only have to listen repeatedly, but you may have to read articles and attend lectures to get into appreciating the music. Examples are Beethoven's late quartets and late piano sonatas, some of Bach's religious music. And the fourth category, I would call it very inaccessible, impenetrable, even after much effort. And I'm biased, I would say most compositions in the modern period. So, I think what we have concluded that there are many nice music in classical music, but to me, some can actually be boring. Now, of course, what's boring to me may not be to a musician. Okay, in category C, I gave as example Beethoven's late string quartets. The late string quartets refer to his last five quartets of his 16. He wrote 16. The last five were known as the late quartets, and they occupy a special place in music literature. And I like to quote this to illustrate a famous author of authors of the book called Man of Music has this quote. It is not easy to come away with a first hearing of this quartet with a desire to hear them again. But if you do survive the first shock, then go back to it again and again, you will almost certain to end up thinking the last five quartets among the most soul satisfying music ever composed. And I would add this type into this type of music, the second movement of Beethoven's Piano Sonata to this category. Of course, this may not mean very much to you, but if you do get interested in classical music, you may appreciate these statements later on. Now, instead of continuing with section 4, 5, and 6, I want now to break into section 7. It has been said that music has the ability to invoke a full spectrum of human emotions and feelings. So in section 7, we will demonstrate this by playing various music pieces to show this. And I will play it, as you have seen already, directly from YouTube. And I hope you would like what you hear, at least some of them. In section, section 5 is pretty long. So instead of playing music continuously for some 30 minutes or so, then I would be standing here like a fool, right? So I don't want to do that. I will break into section 7 with section 4, 5, and 6 at appropriate intervals. So I won't remain standing and be silent all the time. So in section 8, I will say a few words about operas. The talk then proceeds with the rest of the stuff. So let us go into section 7. And I have a number of categories: music that celebrates the beauty of nature, music that is peaceful and serene, joyful, heroic, patriotic, romantic love, religious, longing, homesick, melancholy, overwhelming grief. In fact, I have to skip a few of these because of time, and you will see a lot of links following this, and I will only play pieces with an asterisk in the slides which follow, and also only play long enough to illustrate the point during the lecture, again because of the a limitation of time. So let us begin with music that celebrates the beauty of nature. For this, I chose from two pieces by Beethoven, his Pastoral Symphony, I guess in Chinese is 庭云高扬王. It's very easy to appreciate, so I put it in category A. And then another one, is Sonata for Violin and Piano number 5, sometimes called the Spring Sonata. In the Pastoral Symphony of Beethoven, the music is programmed. It's called program music, and it's the only composition by Beethoven of this category. By program music, it means music designed to invoke an idea or an atmosphere. Beethoven annotates the beginning of each movement of this symphony as follows. The first movement is awakening of cheerful feelings upon arrival in the countryside. Second movement is the scene by the brook. The third one, merry gathering of country folk, and then there's the thunderstorm, and finally the shepherd's song, cheerful and thankful feelings after the storm. I will only play the first movement partially, and the last movement again partially. So the first movement, the joyful feeling you experience when you go into the countryside. Okay, so let's see whether do you have this feeling? Going to the countryside with all this beautiful scenery. Idea. In fact, the homework is for you to finish what I don't finish, okay? Now, the fifth movement is the gratitude expressed by the shepherd after the thunderstorm. A little different compared to the first. I chose to illustrate is the Spring Sonata for violin and piano. I only play the first movement. It expresses the joy when winter is over and spring is here. Oh, that's the problem with YouTube. That's not the Spring Sonata. Now it is. Do you feel spring is coming or already here? This is not winter. Now the next category is somewhat similar but not quite the same. It's peaceful and serene. There are so many pieces, it's hard to nail down any one or two. So I have listed quite a number, but let me play the first two. First one is the air in G string by Johann Sebastian Bach, and see whether we feel any peaceful in this music. One of the difficult things for me is to decide when to stop. Okay, now let me play the second one by Mozart. Okay. This is the same one I just played. Yeah, this is Mozart. I'll start